Welcome to the Faith Lift Message Series. We're focusing upon the theological virtues. At the end of last year, we did a series on faith, and now I'm looking at the theological virtue of hope. St. Paul reminds us, 1 Corinthians 13:13, there are three things that last: faith, hope, and love. So we're going to focus upon the theological virtue of hope. And it's a key word in biblical faith. Indeed, faith and hope go together. Hope, however, is not just the same as wishful thinking. That's sometimes how we use that word commonly in English. So I'm imagining the British summer when we've decided on the barbecue and we're out there, we're grilling the sausages on the barbecue, all the garden furniture is out, and we look to the sky and yes, it's Britain and it's summer. There are clouds and the clouds are gathering. And then we say, oh, I hope it's not going to rain. Or maybe when you've been waiting for a train or a bus in what seems like an eternity, you turn to your neighbour and you say, I hope this bus is coming soon. That's the kind of wishful thinking way to speak about hope. But the theological virtue of hope is not wishful thinking, because it's built on the promises of God. And so it is sure and certain. Hebrews 6 verse 19 encourages us to take a firm grip on the hope that is held out to us, because here we have an anchor for our soul, as sure as it is firm. So hope is an anchor for our soul, as sure as it is firm. It enables us to remain stable and sure-footed amid the shifting sands and the turbulence of life. And notice that in that scripture, it says that hope is held out to us. It's a gift that's freely given, but nevertheless, a gift that needs to be received. It needs to be grasped. And the more that we're open to receive these virtues, the more we will be transformed. Because the virtues, faith, hope, and love, transform our lives. In the second letter of Peter, chapter 1, verse 3, we're reminded that in making these gifts, he has given us the guarantee of something very great and wonderful to come. Through them, you will be able to share in the divine nature. Wow. Through these gifts, through these virtues that God has given us, we're able to share in the divine nature. Amazing. Beyond our capability to even think. And it was one of the great fathers of the church, Saint Athanasius, that said, God became man so that we may become God. Maybe that's part of the mystery of the incarnation, that our God came among us. He came down to raise us up. And there's a big theological understanding of that, so much part of the Orthodox theological tradition. And I'm not going to go into that today. I'm going to keep it simple. But basically, the more we embody, the more we grasp the virtue of hope, the more we radiate Christ, and the more we can make a difference in the world around us. And this is important because so many people that are around us in the world today, they look and they feel disconcerted. They feel hopeless. And I can understand this, I really can, because there's so much uncertainty that we have to face in our lives. And we can feel overwhelmed. We can even feel disappointed. You know, why do I live at a time like this? Why couldn't I live at another time in history when maybe things were better than they are today? But I'm reminded of the familiar story of the road to Emmaus. We read about this in Luke's Gospel in chapter 24. We see those two disciples who are going away from Jerusalem. They're leaving the place of action, and they're leaving because they're disappointed. Their hope had been that the Messiah, the one who was to come, who they thought was Jesus, was going to be a political revolutionary. And things had not worked out in the way that they had hoped. So they're walking away, and they're walking away in disappointment. Their heads are hung. And when your head's facing down, you fail to see the bigger picture. They're turned in on themselves. They're blind to the stranger who comes into their midst. Their disappointment, their personal disappointment, blocked them from really grasping the reality of the resurrection, the risen one in their midst. And after the journey with the stranger, they invite him to stay with them. And it's only when he breaks the bread that their eyes are opened. Now, there's a lot of reflection we can make in that scripture, but I just want to focus on that their eyes were opened, their horizons were widened, their perspective had changed, and they were filled with a new boldness and courage. The disappointed people, trapped in their own disappointments, suddenly were able to be filled with a boldness and a courage that even though nightfall had happened and things were very dangerous, that they were prepared to set out on a journey and return back up to Jerusalem. They were filled with a new courage that came from the one who had entered them in a new way. And then when their faltering faith had been strengthened, they were able to transcend that human emotion of disappointment, that human tendency to turn in on themselves. And they were strengthened. They went into the brothers who were in Jerusalem, and they were truly able to say, Jesus is risen. Alleluia. Strengthened by the hope of the gospel, they were able to declare the risen one. So often, the world in which we live drains us. Our faith gets eroded, even attacked, and it is easy to lose hope. In the letter to the Romans, chapter 15, verse 13, St. Paul prays for the Romans, may the God of hope bring you such a joy and peace in your faith that the power of the Holy Spirit will remove all bounds to hope. So that the Holy Spirit will take away anything that blocks hope. In my spiritual reading over the years, I've been greatly enriched by the testimony of a Vietnamese cardinal, Cardinal Francis Xavier Van Thuan. I hope that's how you say his name. He was held in captivity in various communist prisons for 13 years. And 9 of those years, he was in solitary confinement. His biography is entitled The Miracle of Hope. And most of his writings, despite everything that he endured, are permeated by hope. His biography documents that in his life of suffering, in prison, in being in exile, how he was able to cling to hope in the midst of all that despair. He said, faced with any darkness, we have a reason for confidence. Christ, the hope of the world. Christ, the hope of the nations. So this is my prayer for each one of us at the beginning of this new year, that we allow ourselves to meet with the Lord in the challenges and disappointments of life, that we hold on tightly to the anchor of hope. And in the words of Hebrews 10, verse 23, let us keep firm in the hope we profess, because the one who made the promise is faithful. That's my prayer for each one of us. Amen.